Our first reading is taken from the book of Romans, chapter 8, the first 11 verses. Romans 8, 1 to 11. There is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus, who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made me free from the law of sin and death. For what the law could not do, in that it was weak through the flesh, God did by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh on account of sin. He condemned sin in the flesh, that the righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. For those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh, but those who live according to the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. For to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace. Because the carnal mind is enmity against God, for it is not subject to the law of God, nor indeed can be. So then, those who are in the flesh cannot please God. But you are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if indeed the Spirit of God dwells in you. Now, if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, he is not his. And if Christ is in you, the body is dead because of sin, but the Spirit is life because of righteousness. But if the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his Spirit who dwells in you. Amen. Our second lesson comprises a few verses from 1 John chapter 5. 1 John chapter 5, verses 10 to 13. He who believes in the Son of God has the witness in himself. He who does not believe God has made him a liar, because he has not believed the testimony that God has given of his Son. And this is the testimony that God has given us, eternal life. And this life is in his Son. He who has the Son has life. He who does not have the Son of God does not have life. These things I have written to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life, and that you may continue to believe in the name of the Son of God. Amen. We now come to the third part of our look at salvation, the ultimate purpose and the outworking. One of the key aspects of our salvation is that God required a sacrifice for sin. And the sacrifice had to be human and had to die for sin. Why? Because Jesus had to share in our humanity to firstly experience what humans experienced, and secondly, to be the full substitutionary sacrifice to pay the penalty for mankind's sin. That is, to atone for our sin. Although his blood would only cover those who had repented. We must, in these very liberal thinking days, understand the terrible price that had to be paid to cover the sin of each repentant sinner. Blood was required, blood shed for each sinner, the price of being reconciled to God. In Genesis chapter 1 and verse 26, it says this: "Then God said, 'Let us make man in our image, according to our likeness.'" The connection between this statement and my earlier reference to Jesus' humanity can seem strange to some people, and the issue in extreme cases is one of sheer horror or disbelief. Yet it is here that one of the most amazing aspects is brought home to us. The hymn writer, Mrs. C.F. Alexander, put it correctly in her well-loved hymn, "There is a Green Hill Far Away," when she wrote, "There was no other good enough to pay the price of sin." That sums it up very neatly. She was referring to the fundamental biblical doctrine that Jesus was always fully God and fully man. In other words, for God to bring salvation to a fallen human race, the person would have to be sinless and yet fully human. There's one thing that needs to be settled here. We can forget the false teachings of Catholicism about the sinlessness of the Virgin Mary. The mere suggestion that God himself had to die is abhorrent to many people. Yet this is exactly what the Bible tells us. Jesus, God the Son, laid down his life. As he said, no one took it from him. He had power to lay it down, and he had power to take it up again. To give us, who truly believe, everlasting life. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 21, it puts it quite bluntly this way: "For he," as God the Father, "made him," Jesus, "who knew no sin, to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him." And Jesus said this in John chapter 10 and verses 17 and 18: "Therefore my Father loves me, because I lay down my life that I may take it again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of myself. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it again. This command I have received from my Father." So the ultimate purpose. We see that the nature of the required sacrifice is that Jesus would have to die. The only one who was perfect, completely sinless, would take our sin. What is shown here is that only God could solve mankind's sin problem. Today, so many preach a message which is, God loves you. But may I say that God loving us isn't mankind's problem. Mankind's problem is called sin. And sadly, it is so little mentioned in so many of the so-called churches. But it is a fact. And everyone knows it. Every one of us. We are sinners. I was born a sinner, a sinful nature. And I will die a sinner, saved by grace. That is the difference, because of Jesus. And it was on the cross that Jesus showed what he had done was everything that was required. And God's, the Father's, righteous requirements, as are described in Scripture, were satisfied. And in John chapter 19, verse 30, we find, it is finished. There was no other thing that could be added to the atonement. Jesus had done it all. And bowing his head, he gave up his spirit. It would seem obvious to most people that as mankind is the recipient of this amazing salvation, that that is the end of the matter. But is it? I would just remind us all that there's a clear sequence in Scripture, which we should always ponder. And nowhere in Scripture do we find anything that suggests that God takes shortcuts. Everything is done fully in accordance with his plan and purpose. Taking just a few items will give you a sense of what I'm getting at. The scripture is full of prophecy. Some have been completely fulfilled many, many centuries ago. Others are still waiting. But if David, then the shepherd boy, had been killed by King Saul, as Saul tried to on a number of occasions. Has it occurred to us that Jesus could not have been descended from the house of David? And yet that is what the scripture says. And if Caesar Augustus, not a godly man, did not call for the registration of the people in the what we would call the known world, but the Roman Empire, a simple thing, Joseph and Mary would not have been in Bethlehem. And the prophecy, which is in Micah chapter 5 and verse 2, which said that the coming Messiah would be born in Bethlehem, would have been false. in Daniel chapter 9 and verses 25 and 26. If Jesus had been born at any other time than he was, the prophecy of Daniel would have been wrong. As it is correct to the exact day. It talks about the Messiah would be cut off. I wonder why the Pharisees never connected this with Jesus. They were great ones for studying the Word, the Tanakh, what we call the Old Testament. Could it be that their eyes were kept closed by God himself? I don't know. So in the light of these comments, I would suggest that the ultimate purpose of God's salvation is to be the means of bringing to God those who will worship him for all eternity and to bring glory to his name. Now, you might think that that's a little odd, but the reason I say it is what is written in the prophet Ezekiel chapter 36, verses 21 to 32, where God is remonstrating with the Jewish people. And he makes it quite clear, I'm not doing this for your benefit, I'm doing it for the honour of my name. And we find in Malachi, where God says, I change not. God doesn't change. He still wants his name honoured, which is why I have said what I have, to bring honour and glory to God. Mankind was never intended to be put on a pedestal. Mankind is part of God's creation. Mankind, in trying to push himself forward and be the centre of everything, is part of all the demonic lies. All we have considered, I believe, is how God wants us to look at things. That is, from his perspective. But what about the here and now, today? In Scripture, believers all down the ages have been called disciples, witnesses, followers. What is our function today? If we believe that we are on our way to our home in heaven, to be actively praising and worshipping the Father, Son and Holy Spirit, the co-eternal, co-equal, triune God, it seems that we should be doing the same in this life. We do not wait until we die before we receive everlasting life. We have it. The Scripture declares it. John 3 says it quite plainly. He who believes in the Son has everlasting life, and he who does not believe the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God abides on him. And together with the passage we read earlier in 1 John chapter 5, verses 11 to 13. He make it very clear that that everlasting life, if we are born again, we already possess it. It is ours. It is safe. Our names are written in heaven. We have everlasting life from the moment we are saved. And saved people have a job to do here, not just in glory, to make Jesus known and to be ready at any moment to witness to the saving grace and mercy which we've so freely given to us. I will close with, again, one of the foundational verses which we should all keep before us. Not just a quote, but to think about regularly. Romans chapter 1, the Apostle Paul speaking. After his initial greeting to the Roman church, and then a passage expressing his desire to visit them because he didn't establish that church, he says something which is based on the prophet Habakkuk chapter 2 and verse 4. And that comes right at the end of verse 17. But verse 16, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God to salvation for everyone who believes, for the Jew first, and also for the Greek," or the Gentiles. "For in it the righteousness of God is received from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith." We should be ready to witness to that saving grace and mercy. And it should inspire us to go day by day in Jesus' name and live boldly and wisely in our generation, testifying in the boldness of the Holy Spirit. All around us, we are seeing men and women being persecuted. Their crime, they put their trust in Jesus Christ. Some nations are persecuting them severely. Prison camps, and sometimes executions. But they are an inspiration to us, and to stand firm in the fact that this is not our home. We are on our way to glory, and Jesus has paid the price for our sin. Our sin has been dealt with. Our salvation is certain. Our sins were judged at Calvary, and we have a home in heaven waiting for us. When Jesus came into this world, we hear little about him until he started his ministry at about age 30. And it's interesting to read in the Gospel of Matthew because that is introduced just after it says about John the Baptist. And the message that John the Baptist had was very simple, and I'll read it to you. You'll remember that John the Baptist, although he was born just less than a year before Jesus, he was in effect the last of the Old Testament prophets. There is no record of John the Baptist doing any miracles. He preached the word. He was the messenger. And it says this in Matthew chapter 3, chapter 2. His message was, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. For this is he who was spoken of by the prophet Isaiah, saying, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight." Note what was said of his message. Repent, for the kingdom of God, the kingdom of heaven, is at hand. We move on a chapter 4 in Matthew, chapter 4 and verse 17. It's just after the temptation of Jesus in the wilderness. And after this, Jesus, when he heard that John had been put in prison, Jesus went to Galilee. And then he went to Capernaum and all round Zebulun and Naphtali. And it said from verse 17, "From that time Jesus began to preach and to say, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." The same message as John. Was he copying John? No. It was a simple fact that John was the forerunner of Jesus, sent by God. He was the one to prepare the way. And the message of the gospel, all that our salvation entails, isn't about God loves you. It's the fact that God has dealt with our sin problem and is prepared to redeem us. And those he has called, he knows. He is the sovereign Lord of all. And his word will never fail. His promises are steadfast and sure. And what he has said will be. And what is said and still to come, it will not delay. It will come just at the right time, even as Jesus came just at the right time. If we are believers, we have a home in heaven. But until the Lord calls us home, or we are taken away in the rapture, we have a job to do. Scripture tells us we are not our own. We have been bought with a great price. And all that we have looked at in these three addresses concerning our salvation, they come to a completion. And the big question that we have to ask of ourselves is, are we available for God to do what he wants with each one of us? Are we prepared to lay aside all the things of this world for him and his kingdom? If not, something's wrong. Our salvation is a finished work as far as what God has done. But our work as believers will never end in this life until we breathe our last. And at that moment, we will be in glory with him. May the Lord encourage us through his word. Not the words of man, but the word of God. Let us have the word of God in our hearts, burning like a fire, to thrill us and take us each day in the power of the Spirit to fulfill his plans and his purposes. Amen.